Hi, my name is Laura White. I'm an instructional assistant professor here at Texas A&M Galveston, and I am the chair of the Diving Control Board. I'm here today to talk to you a little bit about our diving program. So our diving program has two components. We have a research diving operations, and then we have a recreational diving operations. So we are interested in facilitating all of the research for all of the graduate students and faculty and undergraduate researchers. We're also interested in training people to dive, perhaps for it to be something that they use for their entire lives, or maybe just for a fun elective that they can use just for a little while they're here at Texas A&M. So we have a whole cadre of diving classes. We have everything from basic open water, where you don't need to know anything in order to get started, all the way up through scientific diving and research diving, and all the way up even into dive master and instructor. So we're hoping that that allows you guys to reach your professional goals no matter what they are. So I want to talk to you just a little bit today about this space, which is our dive locker, and just a little bit about the history of diving as well. So as you can probably guess, the diving that we teach here at Texas A&M is called scuba diving, and the scuba stands for self-contained underwater breathing apparatus. That's not how diving has always been. Most of you guys have probably seen things like this. This is called a Mark V helmet, and while this helmet was actually just made a few years ago, this is made in the same pattern that helmets have been made since the 19th century. So when scuba diving first began, very early on, people needed to wear these really, really large pieces of protective equipment so that they were able to stay underwater safely and have safe access to the gases that they were going to be breathing while they were there. You can see, though, that that would be a real challenge to do other things while you're underwater. If you're wearing a helmet that's this heavy, if you have boots that look like this, it's going to be really, really difficult to be able to do other work because you're going to be wearing maybe as much as 100 pounds of extra equipment with you. So as time went on, we see a transition in the technology that's associated with diving that allows us to be much more mobile, much more streamlined, and much more effective underwater, either for fun or for research purposes. In the 60s, the first person to be involved with the development of scuba diving equipment is Jacques Cousteau, who's a fairly famous name that some of you guys maybe know. And this is the kind of regulator that we see in the very earliest days. You can see here that this is a double hose regulator. So every time you breathe in, it would be attached to a tank there. The air would come in through the mouthpiece, and then you would exhale through the same hose. Eventually, people decided that they wanted even more information with their diving. So you can see here that we start seeing the advent of regulators that allowed you to have information about how much gas was in your tank. You can probably guess that this is really, really useful if you want to know how long you can stay underwater. And nowadays, we see a transition all the way to what we call a normal, modern scuba unit. So you can see there that this has three parts. Of course, we have the tank that's on the back that is our reservoir of gas that we're going to be breathing underwater. It's usually air, but there's other gases that we'll talk about in just a second. You'll see here that it has a regulator that's responsible for lowering the pressure of the air in the tank to a pressure that you can comfortably breathe. The pressure of air in your car tires is around 33 pounds. In this scuba tank, it's around 3,000 pounds. So you can imagine that this would be a real challenge if we didn't have this regulator involved to get that air down to a pressure that we can breathe. And then the third part of this is this buoyancy compensator device. And this buoyancy compensator is like a vest that you would wear. And this vest allows you to maintain neutral buoyancy in the water column. So this piece of equipment is a standard piece of equipment that we use in our recreational and scientific diving classes that allows our students to move comfortably in the underwater environment. This is the fill panel for one of the two compressor stations that we have here on campus. We have one that's over by the pool that we use specifically for our training and our tanks that we use in the pool. And then this one is associated with also with training, but also with our research operations. And with this fill panel, we have the opportunity to use two and fill two different kinds of gases. So as you can probably guess, a lot of the time that we're on scuba, we're breathing just plain old standard air, just like you're breathing at any other time. And you can see that these tanks look like like this. They don't have any markings or anything else on them. Air works great. It's a wonderful gas, and it works really well for the vast majority of our operations, but sometimes we want to try to breathe something different. Here you're going to see a nitrox tank. This nitrox tank has a slightly higher percentage of oxygen than standard ordinary air. And what that allows us to do is it allows us to stay at a given depth for a little bit longer. It allows us to avoid a little bit of a decompression penalty, and it allows us to feel fresher after a dive. And then we also have oxygen. We don't fill oxygen here, but we do use it for decompression purposes for some of our very advanced research diving. So let me show you just a little bit more about this. Of course, we fill from this side of the wall, but we also want to make sure that we keep our fill stations protected, which is what we have over here. So we have banks that are used to store our gas so that we can fill a number of tanks very quickly. And then we have compressor systems. This compressor system is for our nitrox system, and this one is for our air. And so these are the systems that we use to really get our gases down to this high pressure so that we can fit a large volume into a very small space. And also, of course, this is how we mix very specific blends of O2 into our air mix. So you've seen the spaces that we use to support and to service all of the equipment that we use at Texas A&M. This is one of the spaces that we use simply for storage. So this is where we store equipment that's used to support, again, both classes and research operations. One of the things I want you to notice here is that we have an entire bank of BCDs and regulators. There's one here, as well as one in the pool dive locker. And this is so that no student who is ever in our program needs to provide their own life support equipment. Of course, if you want to buy your own scuba equipment, you certainly can, but no one is required to do so. We always provide that equipment for you to be used in labs and trips as well. You're going to see several other pieces of equipment that we also use here to support other operations, including our various things that we use to support safety on trips. So we take trips to places like California, Mexico, Florida, even to various lakes here in Texas. And in order to do that safely, we need to make sure that we have the equipment to be able to respond to an emergency. And furthermore, we want to make sure that not just we are trained to respond to those sorts of things, but we want to involve you guys in getting trained for that as well. In both our dive master training and our rescue diving training, we actually provide opportunities for you to learn to respond to emergencies underwater using things like these dummies. The last thing I want to mention to you is that we also provide a significant body of equipment that is specifically associated with data collection underwater. Again, that's one of the things that makes our program particularly unique, is this ability to train you as a research diver and as someone who is going to do science underwater in the future. You can see here that we have lots of different pieces of equipment for mapping underwater, for taking quadrats, for doing bottom composition. These reels are actually used in cave and cavern diving. And so all of these pieces of equipment can be useful for you guys to be able to, again, conduct your careers underwater in the future. We're so glad to have you here at Aggieland Saturday by the Sea. If you have more questions about how to get involved in the diving program, about any future opportunities for training, or if you just want to get to know us better, please let us know.